goodness, we are.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to this, our third industry interview. Tonight, I have actually the privilege of interviewing our MyTV co-founder and president, Kevin Allen Jackson. It's a privilege because I've known Kevin now for 7 years. We've been producing partners. I met Kevin when I was in dire need. Well, wait a minute. I met Kevin back in New York. We'll get to that in a second. Can I
just interrupt you a second and tell you that it's impossible to have these headphones on and not feel like Terry Gross?
I'm not going to get into that.
I mean, I have a whole new respect for Rush Limbaugh, right? I mean, because that means that that guy is either deaf and has his own radio show, or he just has a very high tolerance for the sound of his own voice. If he can talk that loudly with these headphones on, it's amazing.
Here, hold on. You want me to turn your headphones down?
No.
We have a knob here. We can turn your volume down if you'd like.
No, not at all. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
So, Kevin, okay. I met Kevin in New York in grad school. Kevin is a director. He has been an actor. He studied both directing and acting. He has run successfully not-for-profit theater companies. He has produced and directed many off-Broadway theater shows in New York. And since his arrival in Los Angeles, he has been an instructor at the Writers Boot Camp and is an award-winning screenwriter. And Kevin and I have collaborated several times now on some award-winning films ourselves.
That's
so
true.
So if there's any code signals being passed back and forth, it's because this guy and I know each other.
It's hard to believe that that was me you were just talking about.
It is. So the reason why tonight we've decided to interview Kevin. Oh, wait, let me back up to the beginning, my intro. Why is it a pleasure?
I threw you off.
You did throw me off. Why is it a pleasure to have this opportunity to interview you? Because I realized in preparing for this evening that I haven't had occasion to speak to you in depth about the craft of screenwriting since
2005, probably.
2005.
Yeah.
And so that's why it's going to be an absolute pleasure to dive right back into this. First of all, I mean, I'd like to get started by understanding a distinction that is not so subtle anymore. It's not lost on me. What is it that makes screenwriting a craft?
Oh, my goodness. Well, I would say that what makes screenwriting a craft is the same thing that makes any artistic discipline a craft, meaning that screenwriting is a specific thing. It has, you know, there are specific components to it. You have story, you have character, you have theme, right? And you have to know how they all work together, what they all mean, how they function together to create your story. Just like a painter needs to know, like, about color and perspective and light and the surface that they're painting on and things like that.
But can you separate the craft of would you call, let's say, a novelist or an essayist or a journalist, is that a separate craft unto itself?
Absolutely, sure.
Because?
Because you're communicating the information in a completely different way. Because when you're writing for the screen, you are communicating ideas, emotions, through character and behavior. I mean, you can only communicate to an audience what the character, they only learn about characters through what the characters actually do. Whereas in a novel, you have the latitude to explore the interior life of the character. I would say that's the major difference, for example.
Okay, so then just to clear up, for the sake of understanding that, someone who's, let's just say a good writer, not to put any other defining, or just adjectives on there, just a good writer, you're saying that a good writer might have an idea for what he or she may feel is a good movie or TV show. And I understand they're two separate mediums, and we'll get into the distinctions of that if you'd like to later on.
Sure.
That writer should definitely learn about this particular craft because it's a whole different approach.
Absolutely, sure.
Okay, yeah. Well.
If you're studying any type of writing with anybody who's worth their salt, it's going to be about process. And there are certain things that do cross over. I mean, it's not like you stop writing a screenplay and start writing a novel and all of a sudden you don't have to worry about character and conflict anymore. Those things are the same. It's just a matter of how do I communicate it in a way that's cinematic? How do I communicate it in a way that's filmic as opposed to prose?
Okay, now I picked up this, I guess, outliner. It's not a syllabus, really. It's an outline, sort of an intro to new writers. And I see that you begin by entertaining 12 fallacies.
Yeah. There are at least 12.
At least 12. 12 fallacies about?
12 fallacies about what it means to write for film and television. 12 fallacies about what it means to be a screenwriter, basically. About the business.
Okay.
And about the process.
Do you want to... I think it would be great in order to give this sort of a context. Let's go through those fallacies, and then we'll get into a little bit the meat and potatoes of the screenwriter's language.
Sure.
And try to define some of the terminology that's used in screenwriting and then talk about best practices.
Sure. Okay. We'll talk about whatever you want.
Take it easy.
Hey, guy.
You're probably gonna have to tighten that one there. Yeah.
One?
So it doesn't go down anymore. There you go.
All right. There we go.
Okay. So everybody's heard this. I have a great script idea.
Yeah, I think the biggest thing I would say about that is that's something that you hear from people who don't live in Los Angeles and New York, with no disrespect to people in the rest of the country and the rest of the world. It's not about geography. It's about this is where the profession is. This is where the business is. And so there's a...
No, but hold on. I mean, I hear that anytime I, you know, go home for Thanksgiving. I have a great idea.
Right, but what I'm... And you go home to...
Yeah,
Maryland right?
Yeah.
It's not the way that people who do this for a living talk about their material. Because at the end of the day, okay, maybe you do have a great idea, but prove it. You know? Everybody thinks they have a great idea. It's how you go about executing it and your level of conceptual clarity and all of that that matters. And people who are pros at this, for the most part, will talk to you about their script on those levels. They'll never come up to you and say, I have this great idea. Right. If, at least in a professional context, I mean, maybe as your friend, right? Oh, my God, man, I have this awesome idea.
Right.
But in a professional context, in a meeting, they'll never say that. I mean, they'll talk about what their story is, how it works, why it's exciting, how it's different. Who are the characters? What do they do? How do they? What's the dynamic between them?
Okay,
those are the things that they'll talk about. They won't say, I have a great script, because the proof is in the pudding. Okay, fine. Prove it.
But you just mentioned... a word that's going to keep coming up. When I was reading through this material and other material, it's something that continues to come up, and it's apparently very, very important to the screenwriter, and that is the idea of concept.
Sure.
Could you define that or talk about before we continue with the fallacies, because it's going to keep coming up.
Right.
So what is, well, in the world of screenwriting, what is concept?
Sure. Well, it's a lot of things. The most important thing to, I think, give a little bit of context first to understand is that there's so much material out there. I mean, and not just today, but going back throughout history,
mm-hmm.
that there's almost nothing. And I know this is sort of a cliche now, but it's really true that there almost is nothing that's a completely original idea. Everything in some way is derivative of something else, right? I mean, even something that was
derivative of something else.
Yeah.
What is that?
I mean, everything bears some similarity to something that came before it. I mean, even something, you know, that as admirably unique as, say, being John Malkovich,
yeah,
is still playing on the whole switching bodies paradigm, you know. So there's no such thing as a completely unique story. And because that's true, what I tell students all the time, it's not that you shouldn't try to write something that's completely unique, but there's no point in reinventing the wheel. What you want is a unique approach on the wheel. What's going to distinguish your project is not that you have come up with a plot that no one has ever seen before. It's that you have a unique approach to some aspect in your story, some aspect of the plot, of the characters, of the theme, of the way information is communicated. That would be like the craft of it, that we haven't seen before.
Okay.
And so to answer your question, that's sort of the context. To answer your question most directly, the concept in film is basically your approach, the way you think about approaching every major component that makes up your story. That's the first thing. So that means, who is your main character, right? And I don't mean that, oh, he drives a truck, he has a wife, you know, I don't mean that. I mean, who is he as a person? Why are we spending time with this, with okay, this guy? What are his, you know, what sort of flaws does he have, or what kind of character is he, right?
And this is still all under the heading of concept.
This is all under the heading of concept. I mean, basically, you can think of any story really as having five major components to it. And those would be your main character, your dynamic character, or sort of like the second lead.
Yeah.
Your opponent, you know, whoever is in opposition to your main character.
Yeah.
Then you have the adventure that they go on, and then you have your genre. Right. And the way you approach each of those five components, and I want to stress they're just the major components. I'm not saying that every script has just those components. I'm saying that on the most general level,
right,
those are the major components. How you approach each of them and how you approach how each of them interact with each other, mm-hmm, that's your concept.
Okay.
All right. And in addition to that, and when I was talking about a second ago about how you have to have some sort of unique approach.
Yeah.
That's part of your concept too. And what I mean by that is, I just spoke about how there are these five components to every story, major components to every story, right? And how you approach each of them is your concept. For at least one of those approaches to one of those things, there has to be something new. There has to be something, a spin we haven't seen before, a way of combining them that we haven't seen before. You've heard me talk about that term as a conceit, which I didn't make up, by the way. It's not an original term with me. I got it from my studies at Writers Bootcamp. And what a conceit means simply is that at least one of your approaches to one of those components is something we haven't quite seen before.
Okay. We have some questions coming in, and
You mean people are actually listening to
people
this?
People are actually... Oh, then buckle up, guys, because we're going to be here for a while. There's a lot of material to cover, and I think it's all going to be really useful. And also, I'll repeat this later on in the webcast, but for you folks that are out there now, this is a sort of an interview/introduction... slash, and I forgot the word, what was it that you called
seminar.
It? Seminar on screenwriting, and Kevin has volunteered to also help aspiring writers or established writers that need some help through the website. So more to come on that, but keep in mind that whatever questions aren't being answered this evening, Kevin has made himself available on the site to all of you.
Yeah, I mean, just really quickly, I'll just say that one of my ideas is to use tonight as a jumping off point for a seminar that would basically start with me teaching my class, which is already probably different from the way most people have studied before. Mm-hmm. So it's already got a feel of a seminar to it. And then take that and evolve it and extend it over time into more of a workshop seminar sort of format.
Cool. Well, awesome.
And yes, it will be free. There is a caveat. We can talk about that later. But But yeah, I mean, to me, I'm more interested in using the using my TV to be able to disseminate that information than I am people paying for it. It's not important to me.
So cool. Let me get to a couple of questions. I think the best way is to whack. You okay?
That's the first time that's happened. It's going to happen at least 10 more times.
By the way, feel free to move the boom of the microphone out and up so you're more comfortable and you don't have to kind of lean over. I'm going to just take questions as they come in, and then we'll answer those questions, and then I'll hopefully be able to get back on track with what I had planned out. So we have a question from Mr. A. Buckley.
Hey, Mr. Buckley.
How did you first get your foot in the door as a screenwriter?
I never did. Is that an answer?
It sure is.
No. How did I first get my... Well, look, I say this to people all the time.
Well, you can actually... We can define that. We can define the door.
Sure.
You know? Because there's the studio door... there's the industry door, there's the indie door,
right,
and then there's this door. So
I guess I would say yes. I mean, and they're all different answers.
Yeah.
When I went to graduate school with Andreas, as he said, and as soon as I graduated, I was just sick of theater. I was just tired of it. I was burnt out. I had been doing, I mean, I did 35, 40 shows in 8 years, which is bananas. And I got an MFA during that time.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was burnt out. But, I mean, I still was a creative person and I wanted to do creative things. So I started writing short scripts and filming them. And Andreas was actually in two of them, by the way. And one of them got into a festival out here in Los Angeles. And that got me some meetings. And at that time, I had a cousin in the music industry who was living out here. And so I moved out here. And... So I guess that's sort of the indie route and or part of the indie route. And, you know, the meetings that I got because of that film in that festival went nowhere. And mostly because I had no idea what the heck I was doing, you know, and I still had to learn about this business. And then I don't remember when it was exactly, but somewhere along the line, I got contacted to write, to come up with some pitches. There was a producer who had an output deal with a company that was doing straight to video DVD, like straight to video urban movies,
mm-hmm.
Right? So, of course, come to me because I'm a white guy who grew up in the suburbs, so I'm perfect for this.
Ha ha ha.
But he came to me and he and his partners came to me and he said, develop some pitches. And so I did. And in total disclosure, it was my uncle. So it's not like it had anything to do with me being fantastic. I just happen to know someone who was a producer.
Mm-hmm.
And he came to me and he asked me to do this. And so I and my writing partner at the time developed some pitches. They liked one. We wrote the first draft of it. And they fell so in love with it that they decided, you know what, we're not going to waste this on this dinky little, you know, straight to DVD deal that we have. We're going to take it out to studios and we'll see what happens. And so completely not because of anything that I did other than, you know, who gave birth to me, you know, and, you know, I had worked hard at this point. And I worked hard on my craft. I got my first foray into the whole world of having your script at a studio.
So, okay, that's your story. Now, can you parlay that into advice?
Yeah, absolutely. You can't replace the importance of knowing people. And I don't mean that you're on the inside, per se. I mean that... There are simply too many people who want to do this, right? There are too many scripts out there. There's no way that any producer or any agent or any studio executive could ever possibly read all the scripts that they have to read. There's just, if days were 100 times as long, there wouldn't be as much time. And in an environment like that, personal relationships become even more important, because when I do get around to reading new scripts, who am I going to read? I'm going to read the people who I know, or I'm going to read the people who have been referred to me by people who I know.
So meet people, get out, be gregarious.
It's not about, look, I mean, there's no path. There's no one path to doing that. And you know me well enough to know that as much as you and I are sitting here and joking around a little bit, that I'm not the kind of person who likes to go out and do that sort of thing.
Right.
And so I'm not saying to anyone, be something that you're not. Do it in whatever way you feel most comfortable with, but do it. You have to get to know people. And then on top of it, you have to have a great script.
So first steps in getting to know people in the industry, in this industry, the let's just call it the writing. Well, it's show business, and that's the industry we're ultimately talking about. But we're talking about writing. So what, join a group, join a club, join a class?
It depends on what your aspirations are. If your aspirations are to work in the mainstream industry, then what I would say is, yes, absolutely get into a class. It's just like acting in that sense. I mean, you get into a class to keep practicing your craft, to meet people who are also working at it, to be in contact with people who are actually doing it, so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. But then I would also say that the path that most people take is they become interns or assistants and work for low or no pay for a very, very long time. Either as, you know, an intern in an agency or a management company or at a studio or a production company or something like that. And I know that sounds like it has nothing to do with writing, and it doesn't. It has zero to do with writing, except that all of those people that you're going to meet mm-hmm. are the people who you need to read your script at some point.
Okay, so hopefully that answers the question. We have a question from Celine. Hey, Celine.
Hey. Hi, Celine.
What is the number one thing you say needs, all caps, needs to stand out in a treatment? Is there something that absolutely needs to be stand out in a treatment?
Treatment, wow.
Yeah. I guess what's assumed here is that, you know, you have one shot and, you know, it's your treatment on top of a pile.
Right.
What would make yours pop, or, you know, besides the relationship quotient, which you just alluded to.
Right. The reason I'm hesitant is because the answer to that question is the same answer as what makes a great synopsis or what makes a great script even. What's going to make people notice it? And that is the level of conceptual development and the originality of the idea. Screenwriting is all about concept. And so the thing that needs to be present, whether it's in a log line or a synopsis or a treatment or the full script, the thing that has to just scream out is what your unique concept is, your unique approach. What's your conceit? I mean, that's going to get you much more attention than anything else. What are you doing that I haven't seen before? And why do I care? I mean, that's what has to jump out, no matter what you're talking about. And I hope you're feeling better, Celine. She's had a cold for a while, so I hope you're feeling
better. It's going around. Me too. Hope you're feeling better, Celine.
And hit me back, by the way, if that didn't answer your question.
Slilp Skya. Would you say that as an actress director first, it would be helpful to go become a producer and produce her own work, maybe going through school again? I'm going to take that question apart a little bit and assume that you are an actress director now, and that what you're asking is if you should maybe go back to school to learn about producing or go back to school to learn about screenwriting. And I guess I can deduce that the question, the ultimate result is to get your work seen. So
Yeah, and feel free to jump back in if we're not getting to the heart of your question.
Don't want to mischaracterize your question.
So what's the question?
So the question is, she's an actress, director.
Right.
And she, I'm going to hypothesize has a screenplay that she wants to get made.
True.
Should she herself become a producer or learn about production, or should she be looking for a producer? A and B, is this something you go back to school for? Do you write your own material to direct it yourself and act in it? I mean,
sure.
We're going to get a lot more into that toward the end of this chat that Kevin and I are having, because we're going to talk about new media and where all this is going.
Well, that's actually my first answer, or part of my first answer, which is, again, and I may wind up saying this 100 times tonight, and I'm not saying it to be evasive in any way, but it completely depends on what your personal aspirations are. I mean, if what you want to do is to work in mainstream media, are we okay?
Yeah, Maria, it's on that machine.
Oh. If what you want to do is work in mainstream media, then you should make sure that your screenplay is at a level that the people in the mainstream media expect. I mean, in terms of conceptual development, and you should take classes, learn more about screenwriting if you need to, and get to know people and try to get it in people's hands. If, on the other hand, your aspiration is all you care about is making it, then make it. I mean, there's no, go out and do it. That's what I would say.
And also how we began the interview, which is
learn the craft of whatever it is that you want to do. I mean, look, I started as a director too, and I'm still a director, but the whole reason that I started studying screenwriting is because I wanted to also be a writer, right? And I understood that I didn't really understand, except for whatever intuitive gifts I may have, I didn't really understand how to approach a project as a writer. I didn't know what it meant to be in the business of being a writer. And so I went out and learned. And part of that is experience, and part of it is education. But whatever you're doing, whether you're an actor or a director, a writer, whatever it is. I mean, yes, you have to have talent, but that talent without having the skill, the craft to shape that talent, to utilize that talent, to be able to manipulate it, is not going to get you too far.
Yeah, or do what I did. Find somebody that has that talent. All right, so fallacy number two. I'm going to take time off to write. I just can't get my thoughts together. I'm going to take some time off, and I'm going to write. I'm going to go get a cabin in the woods.
Keep your day job.
Really?
Absolutely. It is... it just... Well, first of all, thinking that that's going to solve your problems is a little bit myopic. And second of all, just the reality is that having other obligations tends to kind of put our feet to the fire when it comes to our creative aspirations.
Mm-hmm.
When you only when you have to work 40 hours a week, you have a limited amount of time in which you can write. When you don't have anything else, any other obligations, right? Everything is sort of free form. Mm-hmm. There's not, and sometimes it can become much harder to focus and much harder to actually be productive. Also, what I would say is this, and this is probably the most important part. The whole idea that I need to take time off, that I need to quit my day job in order to write, or take lots of time off from my job in order to write, is based on a misunderstanding about the way we should be approaching the process as writers. It's very counterproductive to sit down and think of it in terms of, I need to write my script, right? Because when you think, I have to write a script, well, if you're a screenwriter, that means it's somewhere between 90 and 120 pages probably, and that's a big thing, and oh my God, I have to write my script. And that can lead to you actually getting nothing done because it seems too overwhelming. As writers, we need to get better at breaking the process into specific tasks and setting goals for ourselves that are achievable in shorter amounts of time. And when you do that, not only do you solve the I need to take time off from work issue, but all sorts of other things that are good start to happen because you stop writing in a linear fashion. You stop thinking about this as point A to point B to point C, page 1 to page 2 to page 10 to page 100, right?
Yeah.
Instead, you start thinking about it in a much more productive, non-linear fashion where you're developing aspects of your story, aspects of your characters, aspects of the relationships, aspects of whatever is unique about your approach. And that becomes your task for however amount, much amount of time you have each day, whether it's an hour or 2 hours or whatever.
Well, it's true. The feeling of fulfillment is inspiring all in itself. You know, if you feel like you're on some Sisyphusian task of...
Can you say that again? Sisyphusian. Can you say it five times fast?
No. But, you know, an impossible task. The impossible task of somehow getting your idea, you know, 120 pages out, perfectly formatted, first go, that can seem daunting. And the second that you get blocked, and yeah, Ivy, I'm getting to your question. When you get blocked, that then you got to sit around, or people tend to sit around until the block magically goes away.
By the way, what you're
talking about is that, right? Breaking it down into manageable, goal-oriented, easier to accomplish tasks that are defined.
Yeah, absolutely. You need to. A lot of people think that if you put limits on your brainstorming, you're actually squelching your creativity. And
could you repeat that?
That if you put limits on your brainstorming,
yeah,
that you're actually cutting off your creativity. And nothing could be further from the truth. The truth of the matter is that when you give yourself specific boundaries, you actually give yourself the opportunity to be more creative, because it's impossible to create in a vacuum.
Mm-hmm.
There are too many choices,
mm-hmm.
right? If you start to give yourself boundaries and limits, right? My character is like this. It's set in this town. This is my genre, whatever it is, right? Then actually your ideas will start to flow a lot more.
So you're talking about a creative process.
Yeah, I'm talking a little bit about creative process. Yeah.
Can you use that in another example? Well, that has nothing to do with writing.
Can I use it? Well, I mean,
the realm of either, I don't know, music, dance, painting, sculpture.
Well, I'm not an expert in any of those areas.
Okay. But I don't know.
Well, no, I mean, I thought this is where you were going, and I can maybe answer the question this way. I am still, even at this point in my life, I am a huge fan of the Robert Pearson book, Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance, and it had a huge...
One of my favorite books.
Huge impact on me, and partly because I read it when I was young, and so, you know, and it's that sort of book that is, if you read it and you dig it and you understand it, it's going to have a big impact on you. But he talks about when he's teaching at that, I guess it's a college in Montana, and he was teaching this, I guess, just expository writing program for freshmen. And he gave this assignment to write about your hometown, right?
Yeah.
And one of the best students in his class, she didn't know what to write. She was stuck, right? So he says, okay, well, why don't you just write about a street in your town, right? And she was still stuck. And so he said, okay, pick a block on that street, still stuck. And then, all right, one building on that street. The door on the front of that building, the doorknob, right? And she kept getting more and more and more specific. And by the time it finally got to a point where it was specific enough that she just opened up. And she wrote this brilliant, like, 5 or 6 page essay because the possibilities had been narrowed down for her, the boundaries, and that actually made it easier for her to brainstorm her idea.
So the name of that book is Zen...
And the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance.
By?
Robert Piercig Jr., I believe.
Great book. Absolutely recommend. Must read. Ivy's got a question. Hi, Ivy.
Hello, Ivy.
I'm going to actually read it, read her question. I'm not a writer, but I do have a question. I hear all the time writers having writer's block. Is that really true? And also, how do writers break out of that block, especially if they are in a time constraint like television writers? And before, I'll give you a second to think about that answer.
That's an easy question, actually.
That's actually one of the reasons that Kevin is our guest tonight. We had a plea on Facebook about writer's block that was so heartfelt that that we decided, let's talk about this. Let's address it. Let's take the mystery and the difficulty out of this and see if we can be of service.
Well, the first thing I will say is that the idea of writer's block is one of the biggest arguments for having a process. Because if you have a process, then you always have things you can do if you get stuck. And if you stop thinking about developing your project in a linear fashion, then you realize, well, if I got stuck at this point, that doesn't matter because I can just go on to this other thing that's somewhere else in the story, right? And I can develop that instead. And that alone, approaching and just thinking about approaching your project that way will unstick a lot of people, right? You don't have to go in order, right? In the end, it's going to be presented in a specific order. That's your plot. And we have plots so that your story makes sense to people. But as you're developing it, you have absolutely no obligation to go in the order of the plot. You write what you know first, right? And because the more that you write, the more that you know. And so you can always go back and fill in the gaps of the things you got stuck with. So that's the first thing. And that's the first thing I would say. The second thing I would say is that people have to become comfortable with the idea that probably 80% of writing is staring at the wall. And what I mean by that is even if you're not typing away, you still are being productive. I mean, you have to sometimes just meditate. You have to let the ideas percolate. And just because they're not coming out right now doesn't mean you're not working. It doesn't mean that the creative process isn't going on. But people get panicked, and they think, "Oh my God, I can't think of what to write," and so all of a sudden, I have writer's block.
Mm-hmm.
When in fact, it's probably just a very normal part of the process of doing anything creative. And what I would say is, number one, let yourself have those moments. Let yourself have those moments when you're just staring at the wall, whatever that means for you. For some people, staring at the wall means going for a walk. For other people, it means going shopping or playing a video game or exercising or whatever it is that you need to do to just, you know, take the pressure off, not be so hard on yourself, and just let, you know, give the ideas a chance to percolate and come out on their own. And that sort of gets to the last thing I would say, which is that every creative person needs to identify things that they love to do that have nothing to do with being an actor or being a writer or being a director or being a cinematographer or whatever. Things that are sort of your fallback plan for your day. So if you're supposed to be writing, if you set a goal for yourself that I'm going to write for 2 hours today, but you get stuck, well, go do the thing that you love to do, whatever that is. Have that fallback plan, because chances are if you go, I mean, all of this is play anyway, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, all of creation is play. And if you get stuck, it means that you're not in the flow of that play anymore. So go play, whatever that means. And you can feel okay about that, because that is actually work too, even though it's play, because you're getting yourself back into that mindset. You're freeing yourself up.
So what happens
by doing something that you love?
So what happens if you are under a time constraint, like a television show, as Ivy points out? You know, if you're sitting in a writer's room and it's time to get those final pages out because everybody's waiting on set to see what's going to happen.
Well, the first thing I would say is that I don't pretend to be an expert about exactly what the reality of being a television writer is.
Okay.
I do know a lot about it, but I I wouldn't want to say something as a proposed expert and as a purported expert, excuse me, and have someone out there who knows way better than I do say, what the hell is that guy talking about?
Right.
But what I will tell you, what I can say is that this is probably one of the biggest reasons why TV shows have teams, especially half-hour TV shows, so that you're not just, it's not just one person.
So it's a brainstorming session amongst professionals and colleagues.
And the other thing I would say is, look, that's the nature of television. And every once in a while, unfortunately, if that's the world you want to live in, and there's no judgment. I mean, if that's the world you want to live in, every once in a while, you're going to have to suck it up and just say, you know what? This blows. And I have no choice because I have to get it done. I just have to do it.
Right.
And every once in a while that happens. And you notice that the shows where that doesn't happen tend to be the shows that have more flexible broadcast schedules. Things like on HBO or Showtime or whatever, where, you know what, if David Chase doesn't want to release a new episode of Sopranos this year because he's not ready, okay, right?
Mm-hmm.
And there's a reason that shows like that are so good on a writing level, and that's why, because that's part of why, because mm-hmm. they have that flexibility. Because if they're not ready to go, they just don't go. So hopefully that answers your question, Ivy.
Yeah. Third fallacy. I can't get my idea into a single sentence. Before you address that fallacy, this goes back to the concept of specificity and concept.
Absolutely.
So knowing what the concept of what you're trying to write is, and then being as specific as possible. So you're probably going to want to talk about a log line.
This is what I'm going to say first, is that if you honestly think that you can't express your idea in one sentence, it means in nearly every case, no matter how resistant people are to this idea, this is true. In nearly every case.
Mm-hmm.
If you can't express your idea in one sentence, even if it's a long sentence, it is a signal that you are conceptually unclear. If you can't say it in one sentence, then you don't understand your story conceptually well enough yet.
I'm going to play the quiz game with you. I'm going to start saying movie titles, and you're going to have to give me those concept lines.
Oh, my God. I'm a little too tired to do that.
You're a little bit rusty. That's always fun, though. Okay, I'll just put it in.
All right.
I'll put it in your head.
If you throw one at me later, I'll do my best.
Okay, we'll do that later. But
look, I could do one right now. I could say, I mean, I'll pick a hard one.
No, pick an easy one.
No. Like, I mean, just because we were just talking about it a little while ago, and I've thought about it, being John Malkovich.
Okay.
I mean, a puppeteer is unhappy with his life and discovers a secret portal into the mind of John Malkovich. That's being John Malkovich. Now, it's a lot more than that, and everything grows from that. But that's what that story is.
So that would be the concise one-sentence explanation, the concept.
The one that I just came up with right now in 10 seconds.
I'm not gonna judge it as far as, you know, is it brilliant or not, but that would be an example.
Sure. That's an example of something closer to a log line. What I learned at Writer's Boot Camp, and it's something that I talk about a lot, is something called a premise line.
Yeah.
And a premise line is similar. It's like cousins with a log line, but whereas the log line is sort of a selling tool, a premise line is more of a development tool. It's a way that you take those five story components that I mentioned earlier, and you combine them into one sentence that describes your story while incorporating all five of your story components in the most compelling way that you can.
I'm not going to assume that everybody that's is listening now or watching now or is going to be watching and listening to this in the future is either going to be an established writer or somebody that's just getting started. So,
you know, I invited some pretty intense folks here, so it's a little freaky because if they're watching, they know all my tricks.
Okay.
So they could call me on it later. So if you're out there, if you're watching, go easy on me.
No. We want the hard questions. Okay. So like I said, you know, I'm not going to, I don't know who's watching. And so I'm going to sort of play devil's advocate a little bit in order to make sure that we understand at least the verbiage that we're using. We're not taking anything for granted.
Okay.
Okay. So could you establish a context why it is that having a premise line, a log line, or a one sentence explanation of what your movie is about, why is that important? If you could just provide a context for that.
Well,
I mean, is it something that a producer wants to hear? Is that the way you pitch your script? Is it something just for development purposes? Is it an exercise?
It's sort of both.
Okay.
But it starts if we're talking about process and we're talking about developing the concept of your story, then it's first and foremost a development tool. Because if you can get to the point where you can have one really exciting, really interesting sentence that encapsulates your entire story, mm-hmm. then you know your story really well. Mm-hmm. It's sort of what I was just talking about with the thing in the Robert Pirsig book, right?
Yeah.
Those five story components are like the doorknob on each of the doors, right? They're the specific things. And now in this sentence, and if you know them really well and how they work together, and you know them so well that you can put them into one sentence together, then you're actually freeing yourself up to be far more creative with your choices because you know those components and how they work together so much better, you know.
Okay, Celine is asking if you could elaborate on the concept of a story premise. I don't know, did we just address that, do you think?
Yeah, she seemed pretty happy.
Okay, thanks, okay. Maria. All right. So now that we've covered that, then what is this fallacy of people saying, I can't get my idea into a single sentence?
It's just resistance to being conceptually clear.
What is that resistance all about?
The resistance is, well, I think it's personal, right? I think everybody is resistant to it for a different reason. But if I'm being really honest, the reason I think most people are resistant to it is because they have a misguided notions of what it means to write a script of any sort.
Okay, what would that be? I mean, what could be a misguided notion?
That they don't think that it's important to be able to state their idea succinctly. That just seems like a dog and pony show to them. Mm-hmm. When in reality, it's one of the most important things. And not for pitching, not for marketing purposes, although it will help with that, absolutely. But for all the reasons we've already talked about, it's important.
Mm-hmm.
And people, I don't think, get that. And again, I think it's because of this, again, sort of this notion that I'm writing a script and the script is the thing that's important and the script speaks for itself. And that's just all kind of misinformed. It's about conceptual clarity first.
Can you attribute that misinformation? I mean, I'm not looking to cast aspersions, but can you attribute that misinformation? I mean, is it like, for example, I'm a procrastinator. I like being under the gun, so I procrastinate until I'm under the gun, and then I get it done. And I've always been a procrastinator.
Sure.
Is that it? I mean, or is it something else? Or is it just the way that...
No, I think it's that writing is one of those things that a lot of people look at and they think they have this idea that it's easy. And so they just say, hey, I'm going to write a script. And they sit down and they start writing. And there's something very satisfying about doing that, about putting pen to paper or, you know, fingers to typewriter in this day and age, and starting to write your story. But what happens is that more often than not, people do that. They start way before they ever should be writing a single script page. That they haven't done any of the work to develop the concept yet. And that's why a lot of people start with these great, you know, for example, one of the reasons why people start with these great inspirations and then they have all these scripts that they never finish. The reason they don't finish is because they had this great idea, but they didn't develop it before they got stuck into the page, before they got stuck into writing the script page.
Mm-hmm.
And I think all of those things are related. I know we sort of just went off on a tangent.
But that's interesting because it's happened to me. You get so enamored of your original idea that you can't let it go, because even though it's not working for you anymore, you're just holding on to it, hoping that, you know.
Yes, people in general, I shouldn't say people in general, but a lot of writers get way too attached to the first thing that they write. And you have to do your best to break yourself of that habit. In most cases, the first thing you write is not going to be the best idea.
Mm-hmm.
And it reminds me of something that you alluded to a little earlier that I wanted to touch on, this idea of first drafts.
Yeah.
And this misguided notion that you're going to get the whole first draft, like you're going to write a first draft and it's going to be perfect.
Yeah.
That's nonsense.
What are you talking about?
You know, that anyone who thinks that doesn't know what a first draft is for.
You've obviously never read my first draft, sir. Kevin.
Actually, I have.
could you just go ahead and fill up your glass with Diet Coke? I got a note here from Maria. We're welcoming some people that are just logging on, and Kevin and I are talking about, we're going through a list of 12 fallacies that typically surround the screenwriting process, and in addressing these fallacies, which will be archived, and also Kevin has volunteered to teach a seminar for free on my TV. But in addressing and sort of putting a context around these fallacies, Kevin talked about the 5 story components. And if you could just, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 through the 5 story components.
Sure. Your main character, because most narrative features are main character driven. Notice I'm saying most. and your main character's sort of flaw.
Mm-hmm.
Your secondary character, your second lead, sort of like a dynamic to the main character, the person who the main character spends most of the journey of the movie with,
mm-hmm.
or people. You can, of course, have more than one dynamic. The opponent, the person or persons who either stand in the way of the main character achieving his goal or her goal, or have something that the main character wants, or want something that the main character has, but for whatever reason provides opposition. And that doesn't mean the bad guy, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
It could be someone who's got very good intentions. They just happen to be in opposition to what the main character wants or needs.
Mm-hmm.
Then there's the adventure, which is what the principal characters do together in the second act of your movie.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's the genre. Those are the 5. So main character and their flaw, the secondary character and whatever the dynamic is between that character and the main character, the opponent and whatever the opponent wants, the opponent's motive, the adventure, the things they do together in the second act, and the genre. Those
All are right. the 5. Very cool. So we're going to jump back into the fallacies. And then after we're done with this, we're going to talk a little bit about the process, the business, the life. It's going to be a longer webcast this evening, so feel free to tune in and tune out or stay with us the whole time. It will be archived on the site for you to check out later, and we're going to start indexing these videos so that you don't have to watch through the whole thing just to get to that little bit of information that you want to remind yourself of. So, okay, we were talking about the first draft. And how people...
What I was about to say was that Ernest Hemingway pretty famously said that all first drafts are crap. And that's because the purpose of a first draft is not to have other people read it. A first draft is for mind vomit only.
Mind vomit.
That's right. because just the nature of writing, and this is not specific to screenplays, this is specific to any kind of writing. Is the nature of the process most of the time is that it is easier to deal with your ideas once they're out of your head and on the page. Once they're out of your head and on the page, they become much easier to develop, to manipulate, and so on. And in your first draft, you don't want to edit yourself. So you're not worried about manipulating them and shaping them so much at that point. You're just getting them out of your head. Now, they're going to have some shape, obviously. But it's not the primary goal of the first draft. The primary goal is just to learn more about your story, more about your characters, more about their relationships, and get the ideas out of your head and onto the page so you can begin to shape them.
Okay, that makes sense. Number four on your list, I'm entering my script in a contest. That's, I mean, what's wrong with that? Why is that a fallacy? Why would you include that in a list of fallacies?
Because too many writers use it as an arbitrary deadline for what winds up probably just being a first draft and not even a first draft that was gone over all that closely. Mm-hmm. And because of that, and because that's what winds up getting submitted to most of these contests, mm-hmm. there are very few of them that are actually taken seriously by the industry.
Very few contests.
Very few of these contests. I mean, basically, it comes down to the Nickel Fellowship and the studio writers' workshops, the Disney workshop, the Warner Brothers workshop.
Sure, the fellowship programs.
The fellowship programs. Fox has a diversity one. I don't know exactly how Fox's works. And a handful of others, right? Those are the only ones, to my knowledge, that anyone in the industry takes seriously. But the larger issue, I think, just from a development standpoint, is that they're arbitrary. You know, you're not writing for TV, right? You don't have a programming schedule that you have to adhere to. So why give yourself that arbitrary deadline and submit your script to someone before it's fully developed? Anyone, whether it's a contest or whatever. And that's what a lot of people wind up doing.
So you're saying that it's a fallacy in the context of people using it as a tool to finish a screenplay?
Yeah. Yeah, that's a big part of it.
Okay. Again, I'm going to need help clearing up why this is a fallacy, this next point. The fact that you have somebody, a producer or an executive producer, somebody in on the inside of the industry wanting to read your screenplay, why would that be included in a list of fallacies?
Because, again, people use it as an excuse to hand in material that has not been fully developed. And look, if you have a friend who's a producer or an agent at a big agency or a development executive or whatever, be nice to them. I mean, don't make them read material that isn't fully fleshed out yet, because you're putting them in a bad situation, because they don't want to say no to you. They want to help you. But they also have their jobs to worry about, and if you hand them stuff that is not fully developed, they're going to have to say no, and then in the future, they're not going to want to see stuff from you.
Why?
Again, because it goes back to something we talked about earlier. There's just too much. There's too much you have to look at, and if you get known as someone who whose scripts are underdeveloped or whatever, then people are just going to... I mean, people are looking for excuses not to read scripts because there are so many of them. It's a really easy decision. If I see a script written by someone whose last script was highly underdeveloped, it's an easy decision. It goes in the trash immediately. And unfortunately, that's true whether you know the person you're submitting to or not.
Yep.
So, that's why this is on a list of fallacy and list of fallacies. And it's also this idea that, they're not going to be around next month, right? I have to get it to them next week because they said so. No, they're still going to be there. They're not going anywhere. They would rather, I guarantee you, they would rather wait an extra month or 2 months or however long it takes you to fully develop your script, or at least get it to a level that is professionally acceptable, and then read that than have you give it to them next week and it's not developed enough.
What about in the case of getting your script optioned? So I've optioned my script.
Right. well, then now we're kind of changing gears. Different subject, but
No. Same subject. It's one of your fallacies.
Right, but this addresses a different set of ideas.
Go
ahead. Too many people kind of wave that around as a badge of honor,
mm-hmm.
when, without really being honest with themselves about the nature of the option and what it really means, and in some cases, educating themselves about what it really means. I mean, did you get paid? Right. Is the person who has optioned your, and by the way, I'm not one who thinks that getting paid is the only thing that makes it legitimate. So I'm not talking, that's not what I'm talking about. But what I am talking about is, well, who is this person that has offered you potentially no money or little money for your script? What sort of access do they have? Is this person really an asset to your project? Can they really help get it made? Or are they going to be more of a burden to the project? You have to be very, very careful. I mean, it feels good when someone options our material, when someone shows an interest in our material.
Yeah.
But it actually might wind up being more detrimental to have them involved than to not have them involved if they don't have the real clout to get something done. Because once you get to the people who really are going to make the decisions about whether this is going to get financing and stuff like that, they don't like attachments that don't bring extra value,
mm-hmm.
because it's more dead weight.
You mean a project that already brings with it several producers or?
Yeah. I mean, and what are they doing? You know what I mean? I mean, unless it's a producer who actually spent a significant amount of time helping you develop that project, or it's a producer who got a director attached or got some stars attached, what are they really bringing to the table? And that's what you have to ask yourself. I mean, that's because that's what a producer is for, at least at that stage in the process. It's finding the material and developing it with the writer, attaching the talent, and finding the money. That's it. And if you're not doing one of those three things, then you're dead weight.
Well, you know, since we're on this subject, maybe unintended, but still great to hear. Because I'm sure there's lots of writers out there that, you know, want people to jump on board their projects and help get it made, but the people are asking for an associate producer or a co-producer credit. Does that also count? I mean, is a co-producer?
It's a little bit different in the scenario you're referring to, because you're talking about things that are independently produced, and I was just referring to stuff that's more going to go through the mainstream studio process. I mean, it still exists. It could still be a problem.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you may be looking for trying to finance your project outside of the studio system, and you find someone who says, okay, fine, I'll give you $500,000 or $1 million or whatever. But then they look at, you know, who's attached, and they're like, who's this guy?
Right.
You know, that guy doesn't get a percentage of this. Why should he? What did he do? Mm. So to a certain extent, you know, that there are times when it's the same, but in the type of projects you're talking about, I mean, it's an easy way to say thank you to someone, you know. I mean, whether it's you know, they gave me an hour in their on their sound stage, or they, you know, they let me have the camera for free or whatever, you know, it's a nice way to say thank you, to give them a producer credit or an associate. Well, not a producer credit, but an associate producer or
right.
a co-producer credit. And that's fine. And that's it's a different thing.
Okay. Let's talk about the rewriting fallacy.
All right. So
I've rewritten my script 10 times. It's perfect. You said do it 10 times. It's been done 10 times.
Right. Well, the reason this is on the list is because most people have a misguided, or not most people, I keep saying that, and it's not what I mean, but many people have a misguided notion about what rewriting is, and as a result, they wind up just sort of editing and swirling words around the page. And I mean, if you spend 2 hours fixing typos and addressing grammar errors and punctuation problems and stuff like that, you know, changing to the and those sorts of things, you're not rewriting. You're just kind of swirling words around the page. Because of what I just said about first drafts and how they're just meant to be mind vomit, if you're really rewriting, you are, especially in the early stages, you're generally needing to bring anywhere from 30 to 50% new material to the draft. That means new ideas for scenes. It means new characters, new character interactions, new set piece moments, whatever the case may be. Mm-hmm. And if you're not bringing that much new material in the early drafts, you're probably not effectively rewriting. Okay. You probably think you are, but you're really just swirling words around the page.
Can I back up a little bit right now?
You may do whatever you'd like, man.
Anything?
Are you cold?
Anything?
It is a little cold.
I'm holding back. I'm feeling insecure.
By the way, we didn't address this, but I guess maybe because of my choice of shirt tonight, you couldn't wear the shirt that you've worn for the first two interviews, because we would both be in blue.
Yeah.
So I hope that didn't throw a curveball at you. You know, you have to. New shirt.
My mom wanted me to wear a green sweater today. What do you want me to tell you? Wow, I'm thrown off. I'm thrown off now. Okay, no.
Good, that was the master plan.
Backing up. Okay, the rewriting process and having that 30 to 40% new material. I'd like to get into that and maybe talk a little bit, take a break from the list and get into what that means on a nuts and bolts level. So talk about how the screenwriting process is different from, let's say, a novel or a short story. What it is about the screen, what demands a screenplay has that are different than other kinds of writing, how it is that things need to be presented in a screenplay that's different than other forms of literature, and then wrap that into what it is about the rewriting process that you're brainstorming to add to a screenplay.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. If I miss any of that,
I'll help you out.
Well, the first thing I heard you say was, what's the difference between screenwriting and, say, writing a novel?
Yeah, we've already addressed...
And we've already addressed that a little bit.
We've addressed that a little bit, but now I'm talking about the actual writing of it. I'm sort of baiting you here.
Thank God somebody is.
Yeah. In that, you know, it's about action.
Yeah, I mean, that is the major...
Not as a genre.
No, I know exactly right. What you mean. Right. I mean, screenplays are about communicating on a conceptual level and communicating through behavior and action, not through inner monologue, not through dialogue, language, right? That's one of the first things that's hard for people to grasp, to get used to, is this idea that dialogue is secondary in a movie. It's not that it isn't important. It's just that there are other more dynamic ways that the medium allows us to communicate information. And if a character is going to say something, then it better be pretty important. It better reveal something about who that character is and who that character wants. It better be the most interesting way to effectively communicate whatever needs to be communicated in that moment. Mm-hmm. Whereas in a play, for example, a stage play, language is far more important, obviously. Language is the primary way that you are communicating the story in a stage play. And in a novel, a lot of it has to do with the inner life of the character and having the ability to discuss. I mean, and I know we have some novelists listening tonight, and... I am not a novelist, so I don't want to step on anybody's toes. because that's not my area of expertise. But if we're talking about the differences in the way things get communicated, and again, we talked about this earlier, certainly in a novel, you have the freedom to discuss interior of a person. And in a screenplay, you can't, because you have to stick to...
So how would you do it in a screenplay?
So the way you would do it in a screenplay is...
Can you use Silence of the Lambs? I mean, that just came to mind. Because that's the reason why is because you're talking about the psychology of a serial killer.
You know
killer.
What? I'm going to use another example, if you don't mind.
I
just
don't
because
mind.
It just popped into my head. And it's one that I've used a lot in the past, and it's a lot clearer.
Okay.
As Good as It Gets... With Jack Nicholson and Helen Hunt and Greg Kinnear.
Yep.
So there's this amazing scene. And I like the movie. I mean, I don't think it's a fantastic movie, but I think it's a really good movie. Mm-hmm. But there's a fantastic scene in that movie that ever since it came out and I saw it, I use it as a teaching tool all the time. And it's pretty early on, and there's no dialogue in it. And it's simply Jack Nicholson comes home. His character comes home. He does the whole thing with the doors where he locks and unlocks his, you know, all of his locks 50 times, right? And then he goes into the bathroom, right? And he turns on the water, but only the hot water, to the point where it's steam rising out of his sink. And then he opens up his medicine cabinet, and there are 50 bars of soap wrapped in plastic, right? He takes one out. He unwraps it. He scrunches up the plastic. He throws it into the garbage can. He furiously washes his hands with it, right? Then he takes the full bar of soap that's remaining and throws that out, rinses his hands off under the scalding hot water, opens up the medicine cabinet again, takes out another bar of soap, unwraps it, scrunches the wrapper up, throws it away, and does the same thing, right? And what I've just described to you is a bunch of actions. And you have a very clear picture of a guy who's got OCD right now.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, if this were a novel,
mm-hmm.
I'm not saying that you couldn't do that, but probably you would be talking about what he's thinking rather than seeing what he's doing.
So advice to screenplay writers is to be concise and put behavior into visual action.
Well, the screenwriting process in by its nature is concise.
Because we're talking, remember, I'm folding this into the rewriting process,
right.
And so it's replacing 30-40% of a screenplay. I know because I've known you long enough to know what you mean, but I want to make sure that it's communicated clearly that we're talking about, for example, you use that scene. What's the technical term for describing that scene that you just described on a screenplay? That would be a what? A window?
Well, no, it's a scene that, and again, there's no necessarily technical term, but the word that you're referring to is something that, again, I learned at Writer's Bootcamp, and it's just a label for an idea.
Right.
The idea is windows are little tiny moments.
Mm-hmm.
That show us behavior.
Mm-hmm.
And through those little tiny moments, we learn about the characters. We learn about who they are. So, for example, opening up the cabinet and taking out a bar of soap and unwrapping it, just the fact that it's wrapped and there are 50 bars of it,
mm-hmm.
that alone, that's a window, right? That is a window into a very unique person right there, because who keeps 50 bars of soap wrapped in plastic in their medicine cabinet?
Right.
That's a window.
Okay.
The fact that he scrubs his hands and then rinses and then throws away the rest of the soap, that's a window. The fact that he takes out another bar of soap and does the same thing, that's a window.
So when we're talking then about rewriting and trying to find out, throwing out action lines and replacing them with better or more highly developed action lines from a brainstorming process, that's what's called rewriting.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's part of it, sure.
Thinking about what's the concept, what's the genre, what's the story I'm trying to tell, what's
yes.
the pacing.
Who's
and
my
then,
character?
Right.
And how would my character, what would my character do in this situation? And what choices, and then going a step further than that, what choices could I make for what my character might do that are the most alive, the most dynamic, the most interesting? usually, I mean, there are tons of choices, of course, that you could make for any single moment. Try them out. What's the best one? Usually it's not going to be your first one, right? And that's true for every single moment of your script. That's true for the windows, what we just talked about. It could be true for the dynamic of a relationship, right? If you decide, right, that, for example, the relationship between the two major characters that you had dreamed up in your first draft is not going to be sufficient enough to help you, it's not going to be the best way to communicate the journey that you want to communicate.
The relationship between your two main characters.
Yeah, let's just say that you decide.
Could you use an example?
Well, let's just say that you decide, let's just say that, I don't know, that in the first draft of Lethal Weapon,
okay,
right, that, you know, that the Danny Glover character was also sort of, you know, off his rocker, was also not all there mentally, just like the Mel Gibson character is,
yeah,
right? That you could make the argument in your discovery process, in your rewriting process. Well, what I really want to do is I want to show this journey of this guy who is suicidal in the beginning and he hates life and he doesn't think there's anything left for him. And by the end, he is full of life, right? That's the journey that I want him to go on. He's full of life. Maybe he starts a new relationship. He doesn't want to kill himself anymore. He's motivated, whatever the case may be, right? I might decide, well, someone who's just like him might not be the best dynamic, might not challenge him in the ways I need him to be challenged in order to make that journey happen, to get from suicidal to hopeful or whatever, right? So I decide, okay, well, I need to bring new ideas for what this dynamic is. Well, what if he's a sort of close to the vest family guy? You know, how does that inform my existing scenes? What ideas does it give me for new scenes? What does it tell me about the change? How does that change the relationship? How does that add to how well I'm able to get my main character from this point A at the beginning to point B at the end? All those things.
Well, that was fascinating. I'm on board. Okay, I'm gonna go back to the fallacies.
Okay.
I don't want to work in television. Do you hear that often?
Not in Los Angeles, you don't.
Right,
but you do hear it a lot out in the rest of the world.
Still,
to a very large extent, yeah. It's less now, and I know
extraordinary now.
I know where you're going with that,
yeah.
But there's still this idea out there that there's something more grand or more legitimate or more, I don't know what the word.
Legitimate is
there's
the
something
word.
More legitimate about writing a feature.
Yeah.
Which is a completely misguided notion, by the way, because of what you're starting to allude to, which is that, and this isn't an answer to your question, I just want to go to where you started to go.
All right.
Which is that because of what the studios have decided. I mean, they didn't sit down and say, this is what we're going to do, but the way the whole process has evolved and the types of movies that they're making. What you've seen is this situation where people who want to make a living as a writer, but don't want to write Spider-Man,
yeah,
or Superman, or, you know, fill in the blank, right? And there's nothing wrong with those films. It's just that some people don't want to write that stuff, right? That's not their thing. Those people are migrating to television. I mean, some of the greatest writers in this country certainly are working in television right now. And it's funny, we were having a conversation with Seth Jarrett about this morning, that the cable channels in particular have decided that we want edgier stories. We want to hear more unique voices. And so there's a lot greater latitude to do more things in television than there is right now in the feature world. Yeah. So yes, there is a lot of great work that's happening on television right now.
Okay.
Especially on the premium pay channels like HBO and Showtime, as well as, you know, the cable FX and
Creatively, is it a different process
than writing a feature?
Yeah.
It
would seem like there would be more satisfaction in being able to watch a character develop over the course of 5 or 7 seasons than over the course of 2 hours.
I guess that's up to each person individually to decide what's more exciting for them.
Right.
But the process is different in some ways, but mostly the same.
Well, television writers have more power over the story.
Well, that's now we're getting. Yeah, well, that's more of the business end of it. But yes, of course, television writers are the producers, basically.
Yeah.
Some people have. Anyone who's in Los Angeles knows what a showrunner is. And I'm sure that there are lots of people out there who are not in Los Angeles who know what showrunners are, too. But for those who don't, a showrunner is the guy or the woman who created the show. And it is just sort of an industry term for the executive producer. And in television, the top banana, the executive producer, is the person who created the show. Now, having said that, over the last, 20 years or so, as TV shows have started to incorporate more and more and more production value and bigger stories, they've gotten more expensive to make, right? And so because they've gotten more expensive to make, you've seen a rise of what they call the non-creative executive producer, so someone whose only role in the project is to really bring money.
Mm-hmm.
And so they get the same credit. They're both called executive producers. But the whole point that we were discussing is just that is the writer. In TV, that person is the writer. On a feature, the writer is basically at the whim of the director and the producer.
Seth Jarrett is with us. Hi, Seth.
Hey.
Seth Jarrett of Content Engine.
Hey, Seth.
.tv. Really great to have you here, man.
Oh, by the way, let me say something really quick.
Yeah.
And I'm going to say this because it's related to what we're talking about tonight.
Okay.
I was reminded about it this morning when we were talking to Seth. We're talking a lot about process, and we're talking somewhat about the business, but from a very specific point of view, and that's the point of view of a writer. Seth has on his website an amazing series of videos that basically lay out, this is what the business is. So if anyone has questions about the business and how it works on sort of a day-to-day basis, and when I say the business, I am really talking about the mainstream industry here, go watch them. I mean, it's there,
yeah.
And it's free, and it's available to you. And there are several of them. I don't know how many episodes he has. Maybe he'll type it into the chat.
Seth, type it into the
chat. Type it into the chat, Seth. How many are there? But that is a resource that I strongly recommend everyone take advantage of. And not just because I know Seth a little bit and we're friendly, but because it's invaluable. The information that he gives everybody in his Hollywood Drive and Talk series. You couldn't pay enough for that information, and he's giving it away for free. So check it out.
Seth does. He did bring up a point, and that is that television is a great launching pad for careers in features. I'm going to play devil's advocate with that point in a second, but let me first get the full point that Seth is making in the chat.
Sure.
And he's saying that, for example, I mean, where was Claire Danes before Homeland or Tina Fey? She got her start in television as well.
Sure.
There's lots of showrunners that start in television and then go on to feature film careers.
Well, yeah.
It's big, it's flashy, and it's global,
right.
Quote unquote.
Sure.
Meaning to have a career in features.
Well, look, this is the thing that I wanted to say. Mostly is that television supports the industry still. I mean, things are evolving, but that is still the case. That's where the work is.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, how many features get made a year? Seth, since you're listening, you probably know that number better than me. But the studios release what? Maybe 30 features each at most a year.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. And there are how many studios? Seven? How many? I don't even remember.
Universal, Paramount, Fox, Disney, Sony. Five.
There are five?
Yeah.
Now we have to have left someone out. But anyway, okay, but the point is, right, that's what, 100, 200 projects that get released each year, features?
Yeah.
That's nothing. That's so 100 people or 200 people, whatever the number is, that's how many work this year? I mean, plus, yes, of course, you have multiple writers on this project, but it's still a small amount. Television supports the industry. I mean, and the sooner you can kind of get hip to that and get comfortable with it, the better. And not only that, but there is the creative part of it, which is that cable networks are taking more risks and they'll actually give you a lot more freedom and a lot more control.
Mm. The devil's advocate part of that I prefaced with that I was going to bring up is that, the type of television that we've been seeing for the past 3-4 years. No, wait, since The Sopranos. Wait.
At least since The Sopranos.
That's really, really great stuff on every single creative level of production.
Certainly the first several seasons.
I mean, photography, production crew, acting, directing, mm-hmm. story, everything.
Right.
Everything about it. So I don't think that it's a do this and then you can go there. I don't think that there's any problem with a do this and keep doing this.
Keep doing it, sure.
Yeah.
I agree.
I mean, Breaking Bad is extraordinary television. The Wire was and continues to be because it lives on extraordinary television.
Right. And even, by the way, if...
I mean, wait. I put it in a box.
Mm-hmm.
I said extraordinary television, extraordinary storytelling.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, no, absolutely.
It's not a comparative. It doesn't bear comparison. It just on its own, it's really, really well developed, well honed, well told stories.
Yes, absolutely. I totally agree with you. And the only other thing I was going to throw out there is that if you wind up being a staff writer on one of these things, then you're always going to have a hiatus. And if what you really want to do in your downtime is write a feature, develop a feature, you'll have time to do that.
Mm-hmm.
But the work is in TV.
What is the draw? Oh, well, it's, we already said, I just wanted to keep beating this dead horse. He is,
flog the dead horse.
Flog the dead horse. I shall. It's a good name for a band.
Flog the dead horse.
Yeah. Why not?
All right. We're starting it tomorrow.
My vision is independent. I'm not making a studio picture. There's a fallacy.
Yes.
What does that fallacy apply to?
What it applies to, again, is this. It's a misperception about what makes any movie work. Whether you're talking about and what makes any movie successful, right? On certain levels, the same things that make The Matrix or made The Matrix, for example, successful, or the things that made Being John Malkovich successful. Or I love that movie with Mark Ruffalo and...
one of my favorite actors.
And the Laura Linney.
Mark Ruffalo, Laura Linney.
Yeah, and it was based off of a Lonergan play, I think. Someone help me out. Someone's got to know this.
Maria.
You Can Count on Me.
Thanks, Maria. Right.
Thank you very much. They both succeed because the film, because the writers and the filmmakers in general did as much as they could to squeeze as much entertaining potential out of those concepts as they could. Right? It doesn't have to do with one is a sci-fi futuristic thriller action movie thing. And
yeah.
And one is this little sort of family drama thing. They're both concepts. They both have their entertainment value. And in each case, you have to work as a writer to develop, to develop the entertaining potential of that idea, no matter what it is. So it's just, it's a false comparison, I guess, is what I'm saying. You know, thinking about your script in terms of indie or Hollywood, or it's not useful to you. Just identify what the idea is, what's unique about it, and develop that, and don't worry about anything else.
So there's no such thing as being a studio writer or being an indie writer. You're just a storyteller. Is that what you're saying?
Well, no. I mean, of course, certain ideas are going to appeal more to the studios.
Okay, so could you talk a little bit then about the fundamentals of that? Let's just say concept and high concept, for example. I mean, would that be a way of illustrating indie versus studio?
No, well, yes to a certain extent, I guess. But look, the studios are making movies that they can turn into franchises. They're mm-hmm. It's a rough game, okay? If you're just trying to make money off of the return on a movie, it's a risk, right? With all the money that has to go into it, it's such an enormous risk. And so they want things that they can turn into sequels, and they can make the theme park ride, and they can sell the T-shirts and the video game and all that stuff, right? Because then they'll have more sources of revenue. That's fine. I mean, they're a business. Don't kid yourself. Hollywood is here to make money, and that's it.
Yeah.
It just so happens that they're making money doing something that crosses over with something that we're passionate about on a creative level.
Yeah.
And
storytelling.
Yeah. And that's fine. That's what they do, right?
Well, that's what we all want to do.
Well, I don't know. I mean, I don't think we all want to, right?
Well, we all want to make a living doing this.
Well, we all want to make a living. That is certainly true.
So, I mean, the end result is that we all want to make money. To be able to continue to be storytellers and tell stories in our own capacity, right?
Right. Right. You know, and yeah, I kind of forgot where we were going with this point, but oh yeah, let's answer Seth's question instead of me trying to remember what the heck we were just talking
well,
about.
Well, you were talking about okay.
No, go ahead. I don't care.
No, what we'll go to Seth's question. it's a trick question. I can see it. Yeah, there's a big trap in this one. What are some of your best tips for writers? Tricks of the trade.
Some of my best tips for writers? Aren't we talking about all that right now?
That's why it's a trick question.
Everything I've said tonight.
Right. That's the best tip.
Yeah, I mean, well, that's true, too. There's nothing that begets writing like writing, if that's what you're referring to. I mean, if you're feeling like you don't have anything interesting to say, or that you just don't know where to start today with the project, then open up your journal and write that 100,000 times, if you have to do that. Right?
Yeah.
Just open up your journal and write, I am boring. I suck. I'm never going to have an original idea. I don't know why I even bother. Who would ever be interested in what I have to say? And what happens because of the nature of writing and the nature of who we are, I guess, as human beings, is that eventually that turns into, well, you know what? I could have the character do this, and oh, this would be a great scene. And so you work your way out of it writing. So by writing, even if it's just journal writing. Now, I'm not advocating that as the strategy all the time. I'm just giving one example.
Yeah.
If you're, you know, that just the process of writing brings on more writing, brings on more ideas.
Is there any, okay.
No matter what the writing is.
Could you talk a little bit about the old standby, write about what you know? Write about what's close to you. Write about the things that are close to you, and then also, if you wouldn't mind, talking a little bit about getting stuck in doing intensive research on a project. Because you know you can say, okay, I'm going to write about what I know. These are the stories that are close to my heart. This is what I've lived through, seen, witnessed, understand, sympathize, or empathize with, and I'm going to stick to that.
Well, look, that's where most writers start.
Yeah.
Right.
Is that sound advice?
Well, no. What I'm saying is that it's normal. I'm saying that there's that everyone, not everyone, but most people go through that. Most people, the first thing that you write is highly personal. And for that reason, I would encourage you to write it, hug it, love it as much as you can, and then put it in a drawer and let go of it. Because while in everything you do, you have to bring yourself into it. I mean, that's all you have to work with, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, you wouldn't ask an actor to act without using his body and his voice and his, right? It's the same thing. You have no choice but to bring yourself into it. But in you at the same time have to write things that are, if you want to make a living. I mean, if you just want to write for your own edification, great.
Right.
But if you want to make a living at this, you have to write with some eye to what's going to engage other people. Why would this have an audience? Who else would be interested in this? And that means you have to kind of transcend just whatever's important to you personally. A little bit. At least a little bit. You have to think about why this is going to be entertaining to someone besides my mom.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and my best friend or whatever.
And why would it be entertaining to somebody besides your mom? I mean,
Because instead of dwelling on what is a very comforting experience, which is writing about this highly personal thing that happened to me, even if I'm not doing it directly, if I'm trying to sort of be indirect about it, that feels really good to do that. But that has nothing to do with conceptually developing a script. That has nothing to do, I mean, it could be part of developing the idea, but have you thought about who your main character is and what sort of flaws he or she has and who's going to interact with that main character and what journey they're going to go on and, you know, where you want them to end up in the end and what's the theme of all of this and what's the arena, like where is this? I mean, have you thought about all of these different conceptual decisions or are you just writing something because it feels good to get it out? I guess that's what I'm talking about.
Any tips for people that think that the second that they have a manager or an agent, all their problems are solved?
Go back to the beginning of this conversation and listen to it again.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter. I mean, it helps, of course. But you don't need an agent as much as you need a representable script. And when you have a again, we're talking about, I mean, if you're talking about agents and managers, then for the most part, we're talking about the mainstream industry here. And if that's what you want to do, then you need a representable script. And when you do, you'll get lots of meetings. It'll open up lots of doors. But you have to take the time to learn what that means.
Is that the theory of the cream rises to the top? That if you write a good script, ultimately people are going to want to read it and people are going to want to recommend you and people are going to want to introduce you to other people and so on.
That's part of it, yes. That's true. But it also means having your expectations in line and knowing, you know, knowing what, who's looking for what.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if you want to... I'm trying to give a good example. Just know that, I mean, look at the stories that the movies that the people who you are submitting to are making in general, right?
Mm-hmm.
Is it anything like what you're doing? Because if it's not, you know, if your story is about ant farmers in Idaho or something, I mean, that might
be... Has that been done?
Not that I can... Maybe we should write it.
There's a unique story. There's a concept, huh?
Right. And it might be a great movie.
Yeah.
And it would never get anywhere in Hollywood, probably. Right. But that doesn't mean it's not worth writing. Of course, write it and find a way to get it made. I mean, especially in this day and age. And we haven't spent a lot of time talking about this tonight. But, you know, go out and do it. Just shoot it. Get it, you know. Find competent people. Find people who you respect. Don't do it half-assed, but do it. Hmm. Go out, and you know what? And if you don't have the money, if you write a feature and you don't have the money to write, to shoot all 90 minutes of it or all 2 hours of it or whatever it is, go out and shoot 10 minutes of it. I mean, I was saying this to someone on the site the other day. If you have 10 minutes or 5 minutes of something really good, it's way better than having 90 minutes of something that's just okay. Mm-hmm. Right? And if you have 5 or 10 minutes of something that's really good, it becomes way easier to get the money to do the rest. So just do it. I mean, if that's the story you want to tell and you take the time to fully develop it and you get competent people together and you do it right, then fine, do it. Don't wait for somebody to buy your script or want to represent you or whatever. Just go out and do it. But if what you want is to be represented and you want to have you want to have projects in the studio system or in the network system, then look at what they're doing and do that.
Okay. Well, we covered the fallacies. At this point, we've been on air for a while now. And
I don't know what time is it.
It doesn't matter.
Oh, wow. It's 20 to 8.
Yeah.
We're going to be here all night, by the way.
Yeah, this is a screenwriter's marathon. But I kind of want to put a bookmark in this part of the conversation for when we archive it, if we don't get around to editing it, that people know that at this point, we're going to start talking a little bit more about process. Now, we're not going to go in depth on process because, again, Kevin has offered to teach a free seminar on the website for those that are interested. But I would like to touch on some of the subject matter that will be covered, at least just briefly touch on some of the subject matter that's going to be covered in the seminar.
Right.
So that, we can create some awareness about it.
Sure.
And if as an opener, let's talk about the story. Let's briefly talk about concept one more time because it is such an important component. Mm-hmm. And then what is it that makes a story good?
Well, the last part of what you asked is, of course, subjective.
Of course, but I am talking about universality.
Sure. From a process standpoint, what makes something good is that every layer of it is as developed as fully as possible. And when I know I've used that term a lot tonight. What I mean is that you have done everything you can to squeeze every single ounce of entertaining whatever out of that idea, out of that component of the script, whatever the case may be. I don't know. Does that answer your question about what good is?
Well, no. I think I was kind of baiting you. Good is universal.
God, man, all night long being baited.
Good is universality.
Did you do this to the other guests, too?
Yes.
Did you bait them?
I am. Baiter, a master.
Oh, no, no. Oh. Actually, no, go for it. I mean,
no, that's
I'm the one. By the way, everybody, I was a real pain in the ass about doing this interview, and I sort of put Andreas through the ringer at least the first few times we talked about it. And one of the things I talked about was how I just kind of wanted to be myself and sort of anything goes. So if you want to talk about masturbator, go for it.
Hey,
you know,
what?
It's my interview. Talk about whatever you want, man.
Kevin, how does this enter into the writing process? Never mind. All right. So universality. What, yeah. You know, to make the story universal, make sure that it transcends whatever a limited group of people. Right?
Right. Well,
what makes for, do you have a recipe or?
No, there's no formula. Look.
What makes a story universal?
What makes a story universal? Gosh.
Well, I mean, I can go through the list. Just spitball a list with you.
I would say first and foremost, what will make a story universal is if you have characters who are empathetic. That's first and foremost. Mm-hmm. And it's very important that I said empathetic, not sympathetic.
What's the difference?
Well, the difference is the dictionary definition difference.
Mm-hmm.
That empathy means that you can relate to a person. Mm-hmm. It doesn't mean you feel sorry for them or you like them or whatever. It means that you can relate to them. I mean, what's the main character's name in Breaking Bad?
Jesse?
The Bryan Cranston character.
Mr.
Whatever his name is, right?
Mr. Smith?
Anyone know? Pipe in.
Mr. White.
Okay. You know, he's not...
Walter White.
Walter White. And this is part of the reason why that's such a fascinating show. And it feeds into what we were talking about earlier about how the cable networks can take more risks. He's not a sympathetic character. He does a lot of bad things, that guy. But we can empathize with him. We can relate to his struggles. Because, I mean, now it's been a while since I've watched episodes of that show, and admittedly, I haven't kept up with the latest season. Oh, we just did something.
Whoops.
Technical difficulties.
Okay. Is that better?
I'm still pretty hot, actually. And I don't mean that in any other way than to mean that I'm loud.
What about now?
Still. Way more.
There.
That's fine. I mean, anybody can pipe in. Do I sound a lot lighter, a lot louder, or a lot softer? Now I hear nothing, but now it's back.
Okay, good. Let's just keep going.
Yeah, go ahead and pipe in if, you know, if we're too loud or too soft or whatever. Where were we? Walter White?
Yeah, empathetic characters.
Yeah, I mean, you can relate to him. You can relate to, didn't he start with he thought he had cancer or something? And, you know, and he was in a desperate situation because he wanted to, you know, he wanted to be able to provide for his family when he was gone. I mean, we can all relate to that sort of sentiment, you know.
Sorry, I got stuck in technical world.
That's fine.
Trying to figure out what it was that happened over here.
I'm going to trust our audience that if they can't hear us, it will show up in the chat. So okay. I'm assuming we're okay now.
Oh, well, then we got to figure out what we did.
Thank you so much, Celine. Thank you for listening.
Okay, so just talk briefly about story components. So concept being one. What's theme?
Well... theme is one of those loaded words that means a lot of different things and certainly can mean slightly different things in different contexts. But again, since we're talking about process, I'm going to answer that question from a process standpoint. As a development tool for writers, it, I'm sorry.
Okay, go ahead.
I hear all the changes, so it's funky. As a development tool for writers, the most effective way to think of theme is as the meaning of your main character's journey. Think of them as sort of reflections of each other or metaphors for each other. Your theme is the message that is delivered because your main character got from point A to point B, that meaning. That's what I would say theme is. Something to think about as a development tool, as a writer, as you're developing your idea. That's what theme is.
Okay, so we have concept, theme.
Well, theme is part of concept, though.
Okay.
I mean, it's just one, it's all concept.
Okay.
Right?
I mean, then what would be the important elements of concept?
So there's the important elements of concept would include the five story components we've already talked about, right? Main character and that character's flaw and the secondary character and whatever the dynamic is between that character and the main character, the opponent and whatever the opponent wants, their motive, the adventure, the thing that the primary characters do together in the second act of the movie, and the genre. Okay, those are the five components. Other aspects of your concept include things like your theme.
Mm-hmm.
It could include the arena that it takes place in. It could include the time period that it takes place in. It includes things such as what we call the setup event. Mm-hmm. And now the setup event is not the thing that happens in the first 10 minutes that makes you go, ooh, no. The setup event is the thing that happens that forces the main characters together and makes them have to go on whatever the journey of the movie is. You have to think about that. That's the thing that starts your second act, right? You know, what's your twist? What's the thing that happens somewhere, you know, somewhere in the middle of your movie that it's not that it changes everything, but it just, it sort of accelerates the nature of the dynamic between between the principal characters. It brings everything to a new level. It raises the stakes. You know, because most, again, we're talking mainstream movies, but this is really true for any movie. Most movies are main character driven, right? They follow the journey of a single main character or a small group of characters. So you need to have a low point for them at some point. You need to have a point at which it looks like they're never going to get where they need to go. Because a lot of your movie gets reflected in how your main character responds to that moment. So you need it. So you have to brainstorm that. That's part of your concept.
But now you're talking about act structures as well. A three-act structure.
Yeah, well, okay. Which is what most narrative movies are, for okay. sure. In fact, I think it would be safe to say that's what movies are, period.
Right.
You have to have a scene where the character, you know, faces off against whatever or whoever his or her opponent was and either overcomes them, if it's a comedy or a happy movie, or succumbs to that opposition, in which case it would be a tragedy. You know, all of those things are part of your concept, as well as, as we alluded to earlier, the one thing I left out, I mean, there are a few things I probably left out, but the most important thing I haven't mentioned yet is what we talked about earlier, that in addition to everything I just said, you have to have some sort of unique approach to at least one of those things that we just talked about. You have to have a unique approach to one of your characters or to the relationship between them or to the nature of the story, the journey that they go on. Maybe you have a unique way of combining genres. Maybe you have a unique way of presenting the story. Like the craft of the writing is what's important. Like, say, for example, Memento and how it was all told backwards.
Yeah.
There has to be something. One of them has to be unique. It has to, because without that, really, what's the, you know, it could be a unique take on a theme. You Can Count on Me mm-hmm. was basically just a unique play on the theme of what happens, you know, when the parents die when you're still young. And
what about a movie like The Matrix?
What's the theme?
Yeah.
Is that what you're asking me?
Yeah.
Know yourself.
Know yourself.
I mean, they say it. Know thyself.
Okay. And every movie has a theme.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, I mean, there's probably a lot of people out there who are thinking, and rightfully so, that most good writing, that lots of thematic ideas come out of good writing. Any good writing, right? And that's true. But again, if we're talking as a tool for a screenwriter to help develop his or her project, if you're thinking about theme, think about theme as sort of the opposite of the main character's flaw. It's the message of that character's journey. What are we saying because this character got from point A to point B? They're direct reflections of each other. And for example,
so wait a minute.
If you wanted,
you just saw Zero Dark 30. So what would be?
Let me pick something that I've used as a teaching tool.
Okay.
Just because I'm tired and I don't.
Great.
You know, no problem. My mind doesn't want to go there right now. But,
sure.
If I want to write a story about knowing oneself,
yeah.
about the importance of knowing who you are and about how you will never live up to your full potential until you really know who you are. Mm-hmm. If that's the story I want to write, then where I start is with a main character who doesn't know who he is, who has lost, you know, who is skeptical about the world, who is skeptical about, you get the point.
Clarice in Silence of the Lambs.
Okay.
I mean, I could argue that point, but I don't know. But anyway, please continue. I just wanted to go back to my Silence of the Lambs.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, here's someone who, you know, if we want to talk about Silence of the Lambs, this is a person who, that's a person who needed to get to know herself better, too. I think it's a little bit clearer in The Matrix, but that's probably just because I've talked about that movie so many times. And not because I'm a particular fan of it, although I do think it's a great movie, but just because there are conceptual elements of it that are so clear that it just becomes a really effective teaching tool.
Hmm.
So,
okay. So, theme. You sort of talked about conceit by referencing unique, making things very unique. Mm-hmm. One of five elements.
Yeah, very making unique. Some sort of approach. One, make one of your approaches to one of the things that I just said unique.
Okay. Is there any?
Now, how do you go about doing that? Well, a little bit. Where it starts, I guess, is by thinking of it this way, I think, anyway. We talked a little bit earlier about this idea of windows,
mm-hmm.
right? Well, a window might apply not just to a character, but it might apply to a situation, right? What are the little moments that I'm going to create to communicate this situation, this environment, this dynamic between these characters, whatever it is, right? I might have, you know, when I'm talking about developing my conceit, whatever my unique approach is, it starts there. It starts with developing those unique moments, those little tiny moments like windows, right, that prove that what I think is a conceit actually is a conceit, right? Because you can sit there and say that, well, this is my conceit, this is my unique approach, but okay, right. Fine, prove it. And prove it, the way you start to prove it is by just brainstorming out all of those little moments where we get to see that conceit, where we get to see, and where, more importantly, you get to see, is this entertaining? Is it engaging? Is there enough I can draw from this? Is this enough of a spring, of a wellspring, of a source, right? Yeah.
Well, I mean, I think that broadly covers the elements that go into developing a screenwriting craft. Is there something that you would like to add to the things that we've talked about that I haven't asked before we wrap it up?
In terms of process?
In terms of process and craft. We talked about the elements that go into concept. We've talked about theme. We've talked about conceit. We talked about logline earlier. Maybe genre?
Well, look, I mean... we could sit here and we could talk about all of these things for hours and hours and hours and
right.
hours, of course. I mean, if there's a specific question that someone has about process, I'm more than happy to address it.
Okay.
I guess what I would say is, you know, maybe talking, you know, maybe I'd like to go a little bit more into just the life of a creative person and what
that's
all that
means. That's
where I was
going.
And,
yeah.
And
so, but are we ready to go there?
I think so.
All right.
We'll see. We'll find out if I'm ready.
Again, Kevin's going to be conducting a free screenwriting seminar on the site. So if you have more questions or want more details, he will be doing this on the site and getting into the nuances and specifics of all of this and helping everybody out with their writing process. The life of an artist.
Well, I've said a lot of times tonight, this is what you do if that's what you choose, if that's what you want. You want to be in the mainstream industry? Okay, here's an idea of something that you should do or could do that'll help you get to that goal. And I think one of the most important things, and this is part of my own personal process too, but I think it's useful to everybody. And it's ironic actually that we just talked about the Matrix and knowing yourself and all of that. Being a creative person, I think, means that you always have to be open to learning more about yourself and learning more about the world. And you need to be conscious about what it is and honest with yourself about what you really want and how the choices that you make lead you in the path that you wind up going. And the reason why I wanted to talk about that and the reason why this comes up for me is because, you know, I see a lot of people out there, and not just writers, but actors and directors and whatever, who are very frustrated because they haven't gotten to a level that they feel is what they thought it should be. They're not working enough.
Expectation.
Yeah. And I'm as guilty of that as anybody else is on a certain level. But when I look back at the choices that I've made for the last, 23, 24 years, all of them have moved me a little bit further away from being part of the mainstream industry and a little bit closer to where I am right now. And everybody has to sort of be okay with that, whatever that means for them. And it took me a long time to be okay with that because you can't escape it, right? You see the mainstream industry everywhere, for example, right? And so that's what a lot of us aspire to. I want to do that. I want to be the guy who wrote Spider-Man. I want to be the person who, stars in Breaking Bad. I want to, whatever, right? And when we don't get there, sometimes we get very frustrated and we think that what we're doing is somehow less legitimate because we're not there. And I think when we get into that point, when we get into those states where we get frustrated about it, we have to ask ourselves, well, are the choices that I've been making really leading me there, or are they leading me in a completely different place? And this has been a big revelation for me personally, because when I look back at my own journey, and I won't bore everybody with all the details of everything that's happened to me in the last 25 years, but even if I just look at the last 10 years, right? And I think about the choices that I've made and what I've actually done. What I've done and the choices I've made have not led me in the direction of having a career in the mainstream. Absolutely not. I took one serious foray. I had one serious foray into the world of studio features, and I had one serious foray into the world of network television. I did pretty well both times. You know, a bunch of studios, a bunch of big production companies read my feature script. I wound up being the last finalist eliminated from the Warner Brothers Television Writers Workshop. So I did pretty well, right? But anybody knows that if that's really what you want to do, this would apply to writing or acting or directing or any pursuit that's this difficult and this competitive. One time just doesn't cut it. So if I really wanted to be a mainstream feature writer, or I really wanted to be a staff writer on a mainstream television show, then my behavior has not led me in that direction. I've made the wrong choices. And I've had to come to learn that they're not the wrong choices. They're the right choices for me. They just have led me in a direction that is the direction I've gone. And, you know.
Yeah, no, happily. Happily, absolutely. I'm right there with you.
And I think I wanted to talk about that because really it's not about me as much as at all, really, as much as it's about, you know, people have to know themselves better, I think, especially when you're in an industry that's this competitive. Yeah. And you have to constantly be saying, well, if what I want to do is be on that TV show or write that script for Warner Brothers or whatever, right, am I really taking the steps that I need to do that? Or am I taking steps that are leading me in another direction? And I don't think enough of us, especially when we feel frustrated about the direction that things are going, I don't think enough of us step back and say, well, am I really doing everything I can get in that direction?
Or step back and take into account the choices that develop awareness around the choices that were made and what those where those choices led.
Mm-hmm.
I couldn't be happier about the choices that you've made. I've known you. I've known you for a long time, man, and I'm very, very happy to have you here. Really,
and I'm very happy to be here too. And I mean,
but
absolutely.
I wanted to talk a little bit about that. Now that you've talked about that aspect of your journey, I share quite a bit of both philosophically, foundationally, the aspects of that journey, but also literally. I mean, I've had many, many years of that journey with you.
Right.
That being said, now that we have this opportunity to have you here, we're going to conclude this webcast, but prior to doing so, I want to talk a little bit about, and keeping, of course, writers in mind here, how it is that these considerations were thought out and integrated into the website for the purpose of writers being discoverable. Mm-hmm. And how it is that the plugins that were designed and put into the website were designed, how it is that writers were kept in mind through that process, and how it is that writers can take advantage of the website in order to grow or to get their writing on a screen. Right. And you know, talk a little bit about a little bit, because we do need to wrap this up, but talk a little bit about new media.
Maybe
and of course, I'm not.
Just kidding.
Okay. But so, I mean, there were lots of considerations taken for the writer's sake.
Right. I don't know if I can. I mean, maybe if there are specific things that you have in mind, you can elucidate and,
sure,
and we can talk about
them.
Sure,
I can get into it.
But I mean, I would say that to me, the way I would answer that question would not be specific to writers per se.
Okay.
It would be specific to anyone who's trying to be involved in this life.
Go for it.
I believe in the power of the crowd. And I believe in the idea that there is another way to do things other than how it's being done currently. It's not that I'm judging the way the industry works in any sort of negative way. I'm not. And I think it's a waste of time to do that. I think people who sit around and criticize the mainstream industry for this reason or that reason, I think that they're misguided. They are what they are, and they do what they do very well. I just think that there's another way to do things that I'm more interested in. And that way is more inclusive. That way opens up opportunities to people who might not have the means or the wherewithal to move to Los Angeles or New York. I mean, some of the most talented people I've ever met in my life don't work in this industry. And they don't work in this industry because they didn't have the money to move to Los Angeles, or they didn't have the stomach to continually get rejected at auditions, or, you know, whatever the case may be, all sorts of things that had nothing to do with talent. And, you know, I wanted my TV to be able to address as many of those people as possible. I never want to see, and I'm not going to mention him by name, but one of my very best friends is maybe the most brilliant comedic actor I've ever seen in my life. But he's not acted in 15 years now. And it's because of things like this. It's because of lack of access. It's because of not wanting the rejection. It's because of not having a suitable support system. And I think that my TV has the ability to offer that to actors and writers and directors and cinematographers and editors and costume designers and whoever, casting directors, everybody.
Yeah.
You don't have to, I mean, because of the internet, you don't have to be in my office to audition for me anymore. You can be at home in Iowa or Texas or wherever you happen to be.
Canada.
Canada. Is Sasha out there?
I don't know.
And you can audition if you have the size, if you know what the project is, you can audition just as well as anybody else can.
Yeah.
And if I really like you, well, I'll, the $300 or whatever to fly you here so that we can film something with you is not, what's $300. But a lot of producers or a lot of projects, they don't think that way. It's be here, So that's part of it. I just believe in giving everybody a shot to have their voice heard, And I wanted us to create a forum where everybody would have an opportunity to have their say. Now, look, I mean, reality is that nothing will happen if everybody's ideas get integrated. It's just not the way it works, right? But everybody should have the opportunity to at least voice their opinion, to contribute somehow, to contribute however they want to contribute. And I also think, in addition to all of that, that yes, there are, even though some of them are not the more visible members of the site, there are legitimate professionals lurking about my TV.
Mm-hmm.
And you have an opportunity to meet them, or at least not meet them, but to have them become familiar with you and your work in a way and in an environment that's much more friendly and personable, and where they get to know you as a person and not just, some guy who handed me 120 pieces of paper or some actress who has really pretty headshots or whatever. They get to know you.
Yeah.
And that, I mean, those are the first things that come into my mind about when we want to talk about why we created My TV.
Well, yeah, I completely agree with you. But as far as writers are concerned, the plugins that we're using, the reason they were developed the way they were developed was so that writers could have a platform to create galleries where their writing was there for actors to access and work on. And the way that the plugins were developed were taking into consideration all the roadblocks that writers could have to having their work online.
Yeah, basically we wanted to create a way that you could display your work publicly if you chose. And the risks of it getting ripped off would be minimized, because people can't print your scripts, they can't copy your scripts, they can't download your scripts.
Yeah, it just lives on the site.
Yeah, it just lives on the site, and people who want to read them have to.
And hopefully through reaching out, actors or producers or directors that are out there will want to take on these projects, form relationships with these storytellers. And the hope is that that groups of collaborating artists, multimedia artists, will get together to see some of these stories get made.
Yes, absolutely.
Guys, it's really been a pleasure being here with you for these 2 hours.
What's that?
Caveat. Oh, Celine, good luck. All right, Kevin, at the beginning of the interview, you said that you would do the seminar, but there was one caveat. Do you remember what that caveat is?
Yes, I know exactly what it is.
You're in luck, Celine.
Here's the caveat. The problem with offering anything for free is that money is a great motivator, right? If I paid $1,000 to be in a class, I'm way more likely to do the work and show up for the classes and all that than I am if I did it for free.
Yeah.
And so free to a lot of people is an invitation to not take something seriously.
Mm-hmm.
And so the caveat is that I'll do it for free if people are committed to it. If we say that we're going to have 8 sessions and you show up to every session and you've done your work and you've committed to it, you don't have to pay a dime. But the one thing I'm going to institute, and I'm only instituting it because I know how big of a motivator money is that if someone just blows off the work or just says, you know what, I don't want to show up this week, then if you want to come back, you have to pay. And then, you know, by the end of the session, if you don't miss any more classes, you'll get the money back. But it's the only way I can think of to keep it free, but also provide that incentive that money provides to people to take it seriously. If 15, 20 people, whatever the number is, do this and all of them are committed, I could do this for the rest of my life and you would never have to pay me, because it's not about that. But the second that people start to say, you know what, who cares if I show up? I didn't pay anything for it.
Right.
Right. Then it becomes a waste of my time. But if people really want to commit to it, then yes. So that's the caveat. I'll do it for free if you don't waste my time by not taking it seriously.
That's a good caveat. All right, guys. Thank you so much.
All right, guys. Thank you. This was pretty fun.
Kevin, really, really great to have you on here.
Thank you.
Really great to get to talk to you with headphones and microphones.
I know.
Yes. Yeah. All right, guys. Bye. See you next time. Oh, wait. Next time, do we have our next guest already booked?
Deb Curtis. And then David Gideon.
All right. So
the next two, those are the next two. Deb Curtis is a
network exec. No.
She's a TV exec. VP of current programming, right? She's head, a television she's executive no, wait, in sorry, production.
Head of current programming at E1, and then David Gideon.
And then David Gideon, who is the
former director of the Strasbourg Institute. Yeah. And current
professor at SUNY Purchase, which was just named by Hollywood Reporter or somebody as the top acting BFA program in the country.
So there it is. All right, guys.